You're listening to Legacy Internet Radio, where independence is the key to building your legacy. Follow us on LegacyInternetRadio.com. Call us during our live shows at 804-402-2893. That's 804-402-2893. Legacy Internet Radio.
Holistic care for the mind, body, and spirit. Free Spirit Enterprises, LLC, is a parent company for Organic Creations, Jewelry by Design, Miller Publishing, and Consultation Services. Organic Creations offers you the best in natural homemade skin and hair care products. Jewelry by Design allows you, the customer, to design your own jewelry as it is custom made just for you. Thinking of self-publishing a book or novel? Check out Miller Publishing and Consultation Services. Free Spirit Enterprises is where holistic care meets mind, body, and spirit. Visit us at freespiritenterprisesco.biz. That's freespiritenterprisesco.biz. Or you can call 804-252-6562. Like us on Facebook under Free Spirit Enterprises, LLC.
Tired of wearing that same old raggedy t-shirt to group events, civic, and work situations? Then why don't you check out our folks, Live Action Captions. They offer t-shirt services here in the Richmond and Tri-City area, offering multicolored direct-to-garment printing at an affordable price. Guess what? No charge for changing colors for a design either. Pick and choose whatever you want out of the rainbow. No minimums at all. Discounts at 25 or more. If you'd like to rock one of these hot shirts that we here at Legacy Internet Radio do, then you can get with Live Action Captions at 804-640-7180. Again, that's 804-640-7180. And for all the folks who don't like to use the telly, we got it on the internet at live-action-captions at comcast.net. Again, live-action-captions at comcast.net, and at that same title on Facebook and Instagram. No need to worry about it shrinking. We got you covered. Live Action Captions.
Prepare for your future. Purchase your term, whole life, and mortgage insurance by licensed insurance agent Joseph Lewis. Insurance costs can be used later to help pay off mortgage, cars, credit card debt, college, and medical expenses. Protect all of your investments. Right now, rates are low. Lock in your low rate by contacting Joseph Lewis at 804-397-6277 or email him at josephtlewis@aol.com.
Introducing Kareen Hair and Beauty, your number one provider for luxury human hair extensions. At Kareen, we offer a wide range of hair textures for you to choose from, allowing you to easily create the most natural, seamless installs possible. We are located at 20 North 20th Street, Suite B, Richmond, Virginia. Our office hours are from 11 a.m. to 5 p.m. Tuesday through Friday and by appointment only on Saturday. Give us a call to schedule your consultation at 804-814-9262. Again, that's 804-814-9262. Or visit us online at KareenHairAndBeauty.com.
everybody. Hello, hello, hello. This is the one and only Mr. LP, Steven Sykes. How y'all doing today? Y'all gonna have to forgive me today because I'm suffering through my little halfway sore throat, but forgive me, everybody. Welcome to Enliven Radio, part of LegacyInternetRadio.com. If I cough a couple of times, please don't beat me. I appreciate everybody listening in and tuning in. Sorry, this is bad, but I'm going to get it together, everybody. But I first thank everybody listening to us online. I thank everybody that's watching us on a tune-in, listening to us on a tune-in application. Everybody that's watching us on Periscope, I appreciate all of you. Now, all of you that's going to be posting comments on Periscope, please forgive me. I won't be able to see them all because of the angle that I'm at. But, you know, I keep the camera on the more beautiful people, such as these wonderful ladies that I usually have here. Hey, Miss Curry, how you doing, ma'am? It's a pleasure in having you. I appreciate all of you here and everybody. I want to thank you all. Sometimes, just to let you know, sometimes Periscope doesn't catch up. After like 30, 40 minutes, they try to knock us off and then you have to reload. But in case if you have... want to listen, you can also just go to the tuneinapplication.com. You can go there, look up Legacy Internet Radio, and you'll see us broadcasting there. You could also go to the website, LegacyInternetRadio.com, and you'll see there and all our wonderful shows that we have on the show today. Today is a very good show, and I'm very happy to have this show because it's about overcoming obstacles, one of my favorite topics, and I know that we've talked about it a couple of times this year, but it's always good to revisit because everybody goes through different life changes and opportunities that come and go. We miss it. Sometimes we may have been aware, or sometimes things will fall upon our lap, and we just don't know what to do. But we're going to try to do the wonderful thing, the opportunity to discuss these things. As continuing going forward, as promised, I've always tried to say an opening prayer, as promised my grandmother, so I won't get beat. So bear with us. Dear Lord, thank you for the opportunity to come to you and meet with fellowship with family, friends, online, on the radio, all across the world, to fellowship and have great conversations, understanding, and peaceful mind. And please help all those who are sick and hurting and going through troubling times. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, today we have two wonderful guests that kind of epitomizes this topic that we're talking about. One I'm going to have in shortly in about maybe 15 minutes. We're going to have a wonderful caller call in by the lady named Tenial Hairston. She's going to kill me because we have, I know a Tinsley and a Hairston, but a friend of mine that went to school with Laurel Park High School and known for well over 20 years now, and it's went through some challenges and developed the program. So we're going to have her call in. But first and foremost, before we get to that, have a wonderful lady here, and she's also, we're going to talk about her and her story and several different issues going across the world. And I have the lovely and wonderful, and I'll let people say their name because it's always proud to say your name.
Yes, my name is Monica L. Ball.
Monica L. Ball.
Yes,
I see. How are we going to do it? Welcome to Enliven Radio.
It's welcome. Well, let me first say, hope you feel better.
And thank you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Stephen. Happy birthday to you.
Thank you. Thank you.
That's only from Real Talk.
I take that every single day. I may going to have to make you sing that again later on before the night's over. Yesterday was my birthday, and for the last 4 or 5 days, it's been a very truly blessed opportunity. The station welcomed me with a wonderful party. That Saturday we was at the Diva Bazaar in Norfolk, raising money. I was with Red Cat's brand for Miss Renee Rochelle and all her team down there, and that was a wonderful opportunity to raise a lot of funds and a lot of vendors. We had to turn away people and vendors. It was just that impactful. Had dinner, had brought back dinner. I have like 4 or 5 cakes in the refrigerator. Mm-hmm. Some friends.
That's why he's sick, ladies. That's why.
No, and then no, it's because I can sleep.
Too much. Turn it up.
Oh, gosh. And then I came back. I was barely on the road. I had another friend's party went to, and then came back. And then Sunday I was up working. And then I picked up another cake from a client I see. They helped me out. And then I went to a lunch that afternoon and things. I went to a friend's bar that Saturday night to visit a friend. So it was just been busy. Mm-hmm. And then to actually Monday was a calm day. Mm-hmm. So it was a little bit wild and things. But not just me sick. I want to give a shout out, excuse me, to the co-hosts and the wonderful people, author Tracy Scott, RAWSILK, author Tracy Hardney-Scott. Forgive me, my tongue ain't working today, but she's home, not feeling well. So shout out to you and everybody there, you and your family there. And RAWSILK, I appreciate you so very much for helping out and hope she gets better. Ashley Jefferson of Corain Hair and Beauty, she is usually here, but she had to take care of some business. Miss Tandalyn Harris is usually here. Maya Jones Lewis is here. Everett Sincere. And Ms. Shanetta Stone. So we have a good crew of hosts, co-hosts here and partners, and I appreciate all of them and things. But it's just me today and this view, so I'm very grateful and things. So shout out to all of you. But how you been doing so far?
I've been doing great. And let me first say it has been a pleasure coming back on Legacy Internet Radio, and shout outs to Marcus J and the crew and Mr. 3375 for first having me on back. I believe it was back in November, and ain't no half-stepping with Marcus J. So it's always, it's been a pleasure from one blessing leads to another to come on.
Amen.
And do supporting. So, hey, man, when I got that call, Real Talk got to come back on.
Hey, I saw it. You know, Real Talk, I try to make it happen for everybody. Yes. We always welcome everybody and anybody who wants to come to this station and everything. I appreciate everybody. So it's always a fun time and for to come in and stuff like that. Before we go into everything, we are we're going through a lot of different things, as you see, with the Freddie Gray is picked back up, and we do a bunch of different things on there. I'm sorry, we talked about it several times.
Right.
And we see that they're having a jury, and then as recently as about a couple of hours ago, the jury was deadlocked. I don't know if you saw about that.
Yeah.
Could you tell me your thoughts about that, ma'am?
Well, let me first tell a little bit of viewers about myself. Well, my name is Monica L. Ball. I'm a local Richmonder here, and I've been here all my life. I'm a, I always consider myself a little country girl from Emporia, Virginia, baby. And I didn't know exactly what's been going on with a lot of things. I didn't know a lot of racial bias and a lot of stuff grew up because I was somewhat sheltered, but I knew certain things existed in my life because I was raised by my parents and mostly my grandparents down in the country area, and then we moved up in the Richmond area when I was a middle age. And so as I grew and I went through my adult age, and I started to fought a lot of legal systems here in Richmond, and I see the horrors. So when you talk about Freddie Gray, he is part of my family on my cousin's side. A lot of people don't know that. The Gray family, he's of a distant cousin on my mother's side. So, yeah. So seeing what's going on with that, with the jury being deadlocked, it's hard to convict police officers. It's hard to convict them. Especially in today's society, and especially with the tampering. And as you know, you looked at, we just had the, not too long ago, the 20th year anniversary of the O.J. Simpson's case. And if you didn't have the, what you call the money to buy a legal defense system, a lot of people knew O.J. couldn't get off. And God bless his soul, Johnny Cochran. Because at one point, I wanted to become an attorney.
Okay.
And a lot of people say I should have. And when I did, I got on a legal system.
It's not too late.
I know. And
there's 80, this past year, in Virginia, about 4 people over the age of 80 became lawyers.
Yeah, and you know, it was so funny. Sister Shana, the medium, she said, you know, you're supposed to be an attorney, and that's what my grandparents want me to do. But right now I'm studying for a PhD.
What's that PhD in?
Our business.
There you go. You know what? One of the things that we talk about here all the time, and I shout out to Coach Ellis who narrowed this down.
Yeah.
We talk about everybody has the gifts, talent, skills, and abilities.
Right.
And you can be successful in a whole bunch of different things, what have you.
Yeah.
But when you actually follow those spiritual gifts and things of that nature, whatever that you feel that it is, because I have an idea, but I would not be rude and speak as God, because that's what only you know if you're privy to share. But that's the thing that's going to eventually make you happy and it makes you a blessing to the world, because you have to be authentically you.
And
when you do those different things, that's when everything starts to fall into place, where as the saying goes, if you're not paid for it, what would you do?
Yeah.
And if this is something that you're doing, then hey.
Yeah, you know, when you say that, you know, piggyback on that, you know, when I went through my death situation, I was talking to
you. Oh, yeah, we're going to save some of that. Save some of that, because we're going to get to it.
We're going to get on to that. Sometimes we're going to save that, but certain situations in life throw us a curveball. And it's whether or not God going to give you hints, and whether you're going to learn how to deal with certain tragedies to steer you in which way you're going to gravitate it toward. Now, let's get back on Freddie Gray's situation and this jury. Now, wondering what those juries thinking in the back of their mind.
It's saying that the closing arguments for both sides were not very good.
Yeah.
Which troubles me. Because it troubles me on two sides. Not protecting the officers.
Yes.
But all the money the police unions get and everything else. So I'm thinking about, the reason why I say that is because I'm thinking about the officers that are innocent for different things or who may be injured for something and need good lawyers. And you mean to tell me that, and mind you, this is a world now case now. So they couldn't do anything. And then all the stuff that the Gray family have gone through.
Right.
And the lawyers could not make a good enough argument. And you had how much time to prepare?
Yes.
So what's going on here? And now it's saying that they're still deadlocked. Because if you're not able to prove or disprove everything is status quo, then basically you're done.
Well, see, that's what I wanted to tell you. I went through the same situation with a African-American attorney, and I saw the good and bad side, and there was a learning curve on that. When you want to see what type of attorney you have, if they're going to give their all to you, now is they going to sleep dead at night to fight for their client? Is they satisfied of just giving the Gray family just the money, or are they going to fight to give them the justice?
Yeah, see, this is far beyond money.
Yes.
This is about life. And then the thing about it is that now that the spotlight's on.
Yes.
And now you see him in multiple situations. Yes. Using Chicago as an example, they've gone back old cases.
Yes.
And I feel bad because these are just the national cases.
Yes.
Everybody has stories of situations of smaller counties, cities that we may not see the light of day.
You would never heard the day of life
about how people have gone in and killed somebody. We've been, and not just us, Native Americans, Asians, Latin American people.
Oh, yeah, white Americans.
Everybody.
Yes.
And it's just that this is a situation that needs to be done. You know, be done away with. Now, God knows, unfortunately, maybe still be evil in the world, but we got to do our part as a community.
Yes.
This is why I call it Live and Radio the global community, because although we reach wide, regardless of your race, creed, religion, whatever the case may be, we have to work together.
And see, that's why I like what you said, Stephen, and that's why social media and the outlet like this station has to speak to the out viewers you know, we're not just burning down cities. We're speaking a message to grow a movement, to Amen. Gain a channel. You know, it's not just killing down one another and shooting somebody down. It's about picking up that mic, picking up a pen, and having our voices heard in that voting booth and getting them books and getting to have your voices heard when people don't want your voices heard. And it's so many times people have projected at me and I have taken on the establishment to say, and I challenge people. They say, I can't just get rid of this woman. She just won't go away. You're right. I'm not. When I want justice, you fight for justice, especially you know something ain't right.
Exactly. Because you know how when they say pick and choose your battles, this yes. is, these are the type of things that you pick and choose your battle. Because if you don't stand for something, you'll stand for nothing.
Exactly.
And then at the same time, it's a message.
Yes.
And it's about, and it's, you're sending a message via your actions.
Yes.
And because what happens is, and this is something I express with a mm-hmm. variety of the topics that we have here, is that our children are watching.
Yes.
Our other adults are watching mm-hmm. because so many of our adults, not belittling anybody, mm-hmm. are still did not have the imprint that mm-hmm. some of our older generation and family members have had. Mm-hmm. So we're still dealing with some that still may have the think of a 15, 21-year-old, and they're in their 40s and
right.
50s, unfortunately.
Yeah.
And so we're having this understanding that this is how it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm.
Give you an example. We're like 10 to 15 years into the reality TV aspect of it,
yes.
of thinking. This is the microwave world that people think this is how it is. And because we did not take a stand until maybe the last couple of years as a whole,
mm-hmm.
and we're still not taking a big enough stand in my view, but now that people think, oh, this is how it's acting. Mm-hmm. Now, we have more and more reports the past couple of years, young women, especially young black women,
yes.
and teenagers are going, and little girls and teenagers are going to jail.
Yes.
And now in school. Not even getting into adulthood yet.
Yes.
And the correlation has been made. We see everything else that's going on with that. Oh, we got our caller. Let's see here. And hello, hello, hello. Welcome to Enliven Radio, part of Legacy Internet Radio. Who do we have on the line today?
This is Tenial Spencer.
Hey, Tenial Spencer, how are you doing?
I'm well, thank you.
Well, I want to give you a big shout out and welcome to Enliven Radio, and I appreciate you so very much. I have one of our lovely guests, Ms. Monica Ball here, L Ball, excuse me, here. Yes. And I appreciate you so very much.
Welcome. Thank you so much. Thank you for having me.
And now, I told everybody, you know, for those who don't know, this is one of the most lovely and great people in the world, teammate and friend, and although we don't get to see and speak as often, one of the most joyful women in the world who has nothing but a kind heart. To give all the shirt off your back is an understatement. And, you know, this is a woman who will sit there and cry. If you need water and if you can't, and the ground is bare, she will cry the tears of a bucket so you have something to drink.
Bless you, sir. Man. You know, we were fellow bandmates, too. You forgot that part.
Oh, yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. And things there's certain things I will never forget. And things, there's a hole in my memory in some things. But when it comes to you and LPHS, I don't forget.
Things. I know that's right. Some great times, great memories.
Oh, yes. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. So how are you doing, young lady?
I am well, thank you.
All right.
I'm well, just, you know, kind of undertaking some new chapters in my life. And I'm just really, really busy right now.
Well, I'm glad. And this is where one of the reasons why you're here, bless you, ma'am. We got people listening on Periscope and TuneIn and Streama and on the webpage. So we're gonna tell it all. We're gonna put the whole business out there.
We're gonna
put it on out there and everything else. So if anybody wants to send some dye, bless you, ma'am. Do we need to get anything? You okay? So please stop. You know, if you need anything, please. Sorry. Everybody's been coughing and allergies here, so you have to forgive us.
Okay. No worries.
But now, first and foremost, tell us where you are and what are you currently doing. As you know, I know you're a mother, a few children. And what are you doing in your career right now?
Sure. Well, I'm currently located in Greensboro, North Carolina. I've been here for about 6 years now, almost 6 years. I'm a divorced single mom of four beautiful children. Their ages are 10, I'm sorry, just turned 11, 8 and 7, and my twins are 7. So I have my hands full with them, of course. They keep me hopping, keep me pretty busy. Mm-hmm. But by day, my current profession is I'm a mortgage loan officer at a bank, and I just got my real estate broker license today.
Oh, congratulations. Woo! Go ahead. Go ahead. Another announcement. So, yes. You know, Tenille Spencer's Realty, if you need a home, call her. She only sells $5.5 million and above.
You know, I know that's right.
And everything.
Come
so,
on, somebody. We need those $1 million listings. Hello.
You know, we're going to get you on a, we're going to get, instead of some of those other people, we're going to get you. We're going to put the property brothers out the door. We're going to get you.
No, that's right.
And everything. So I'm going to have to come down to North Carolina and come see you and things for that.
Yes, yes.
So,
that's what I'm doing now. And so I have those two ventures going on as of right now. And I'm working on a book and starting this new movement, I Overcame. And so that's my baby now that I'm kind of nurturing and trying to get off the ground. So
yes. And now tell us about the reason why I wanted you to call, besides all these wonderful things, I know for a time you were having some, and with a lot of people that go through divorce, some people go through it smoothly and like, hey, cool, bye. And then some people go through it in a little bit troubling time. And without tipping my hand and things of that nature, I knowing how wonderful and of emotion and of a giving woman that you are, I know this took a lot out of you. Could you walk us through to what you can, why, and what helped got you through this, and how did it develop into I Overcame? And the reason being, because you know there's so many people out there that's not willing to speak about this. This is supposedly taboo with women, why I did it. And it needs to be aired out so we can help others get through these changes.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. But let me say first and foremost that I Overcame. Yes, it's about my divorce and the things that I had to overcome as a single mom. But it's more or less about a movement of, I mean, everyone can have that testimony that they've overcome something. Mm-hmm. The divorce that I went through, of course, was very painful, but there were a number of things, Stephen, that started in my childhood that were very hurtful, very painful. I don't even know when it began, but I was molested as a child up until maybe age 7. Until I was old enough to speak about it and say, you know, I don't want to be around these people anymore. I was also raped at the age of 14. And so when you go through those two traumatic things as a child, you know, it kind of can really hurt your self-esteem. You know, it can distort your judgment about sexuality and just change your whole perspective because there's a loss of innocence there. Mm-hmm. So first and foremost, you know, those were two of the biggest obstacles that I had to overcome and learn how to heal from. I've seen a lot of hurtful things in my lifetime. And those were things that were designed to kill my spirit. But, you know, through the grace of God, I was able to, you know, receive healing, receive peace of mind, receive strength from those things.
I offer you all the types of praise for that because the first part I did not know. The latter, I had an understanding maybe of it because that's something that's unfortunately been plaguing not just people in our area that we spend time in, but just women in general. And not many women are, you know, they speak about it when they get older, but they don't speak about it of the assault, sexual assault, rape, and things of that nature when they're in their preteens. We didn't even got to high school yet. And I can speak to of how much I know you were going through pain, but I can speak to the wonderful joy of energy that you still always kept about you.
Yes, and that was nothing but the grace of God that, you know, that gave me light and gave me hope. And so, you know, going through those things, you know, and triumphing over that, and then, you know, marrying a man that I absolutely adored, and, you know, having all these beautiful children, and going through that, and only to get to a point where it was no longer healthy for me to be in a marriage. I think, you know, unfortunately, a lot of my experiences as a child and as a teenager, they affected my marriage because I had not healed. You know, when you go through things that are traumatic like that, it's hard to have, you know, and I'm just going to say it, sexual intimacy with your mate, with your husband.
Right.
Your idea of intimacy may be a little distorted. You know what I mean?
Yes, and there's a lot of people that have come out of it in so many different ways that we, you know, some become hyper, some become reclusive. Some turn to go to a different gender. It's just so many different things. And let me ask you a sidebar for this. And the reason why a lot of women have done this. Did you marry out of the protection? So obviously women want the protection of their husband. But did you marry out of to escape from the past of the pain for that protection, thinking that it was going to heal you?
I wouldn't say it was out of for that. I know that I my marriage, and oh gosh, he's probably going to hate that I say this if he ever hears this. But my marriage, you know, for me was a place of security. It was. I need to be married for the covering. I need to be married because it's the right thing to do. I need to be married because, you know, I'm 26 years old, and now my grandparents are saying, what are you doing? You're 26, you need to be married, you know, you need to be settled. So for me, it was a lot of different factors. It was more, it wasn't like the fairy tale idea of what, you know, how people envision their first marriage, oh, I'm just so in love with this person that I have to spend the rest of my life with them. It was more or less, I'm marrying because this is what you should do. This is the right thing to do.
Because of pressure or family life. Like,
because of pressure, family, past experiences, things like that, yes.
Okay. So yeah. As you continue forward with this, you got married. You have your wonderful children.
Mm-hmm.
The marriage dissolved. Was it, and you said that you weren't healed. Did it become of a situation of lack of communication from your end, or just unfulfilling?
There were a few things that contributed to, you know, my marriage dissolving. One of those things was alcohol abuse, not on my part. Another thing that contributed was a physical altercation. And for me, at that point, a physical altercation was, you know, that was my, everybody has their breaking point. and for me, the physical altercation was like, I'll stay with you through the fire and the flood, but when it comes to you getting physical, I can't do that. So
I don't want to take a punch from you. I know that much.
say that again. I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
I don't want to take a punch from you or your sister. I can tell you that much.
Well, you know my sis now. Now you know she plays no games.
see, you're the kind one. You know, I ain't playing. I ain't going over there. I'm walking the other side.
Yeah, she can change. The older one. She's the feisty one. You know.
Yeah, it's good grief.
So at that point for me, it was a breaking point. Now, I will say this, you know, when I initially left my husband, the intent was never to divorce. It was only to get space and to get healing.
Okay.
But that never came. Hmm. So, you know, I found myself moving to a different state with four children, all under the age of four. My oldest was four, my middle son was two, and my twins were 18 months. And I had to find a way to try to put my life back together. And so that's kind of where my new chapter began. You know, it's been a rough one, but...
It's okay. Take your time, sweetheart. Take your time, sweetheart. I got your back. And, you know, it's a rough one. You moved to another state, back to Greensboro or back, you have to forgive me. I forgot which one.
Oh, yeah, it's fine. I moved from Roanoke, Virginia to Greensboro, North Carolina.
Okay, that's right. Okay. I was thinking the other way around at first. Okay. So you moved, you put your life back together. You're still close to family, and you're trying to find another way. And the aspect is, you know, for all who may not know, Greensboro is not exactly the most bustling of economies. And but you needed that quietness in that space. Mm-hmm. That
correct?
Okay.
You know, for me, Greensboro was kind of like a second home because my mother actually moved here in 97. So, you know, I've always been familiar with this city and, you know, for me, it's not too big. It's not too small. So it was a place of comfort. One that I knew very well and I had family here, of course. So, you know, I had to, as I say, get a real job. You know, I was a stay-at-home mom for a while. And so during the time when I was married, the early years of my marriage, I took care of home. And so when you can go away to school and become educated and all that, that's wonderful. But when you're stay-at-home mom, you're mom. And so, you know, certain skill sets I had to, you know, learn all over again and how to actually get out and relate to people. And and I got a sales job with Verizon Wireless and became a sales rep there and met wonderful people who actually poured into me, who laughed with me, cried with me because they were there. They saw me go through, you know, having a child. My youngest son had a heart condition. His name is Steven. he had a heart condition. He was born with this congenital heart condition called Wolff-Parkinson-White syndrome.
Woo.
And he had that when he was born. We discovered it at 2 weeks old. So I had to work, 40 plus hours a week. And for the first, I don't know, year or so, I didn't even get a lunch break because he was on heart medication and the daycare wouldn't administer his heart meds because it was too much of a liability. So I would have to leave work on my lunch break and go administer his heart medication and come back. So I didn't get a lunch break. You know, I would go to work and pick my kids up from daycare, bathe them and put them in the bed and do it all again the next day. It was just, you know, I look back now and I wonder how I did it, but it was nothing but the grace of God.
I can honestly say the similarities in this is crazy. I was born with heart trouble and, you know, I've had asthma and I had heart murmurs and I was a hemophiliac and had a lot of trouble. So I can relate seriously those EKGs and all those
Those EKGs. But, you know, it got to a point where my son almost knew where to put the leads,
It got to the leads and sticking the needles and every other second, you know, you just knew what was going on. And our hearts out to you and my continual prayers for your son regarding that.
He's much better. He had surgery, so praise God, he's all healed. He doesn't have it anymore. So,
Sidebar for this give a bit of a break. Why didn't you continue your athletic career?
Why didn't I?
Yes.
Oh, you know, because my older sister was the star, honey.
Yeah, well, you said, but that don't mean you weren't star. Okay, I know she was the star, but in my eyes, both of you were.
Yeah, you know, but she just, you know, my sis, that was her thing. You know, I did sports because I looked up to her and wanted to be like
but
her.
It
was never my dream to be a star athlete. It was always, you know, I think after she graduated high school, I just wanted to do my own thing. I didn't want to be Miranda's little sis anymore. I wanted to be my own person. Probably what it is.
Okay, for those who don't know, we went to a small area school. 400 kids between five grades. I mean, like, literally, but everybody did 10 things just to keep the school going. But everybody recognized as an individual. I'm more than comfortable. I know for a fact nobody viewed you as Miranda. I mean, no disrespect to Miranda or you or your family, but nobody viewed you as Miranda's little sister.
But, you know, but that's how you feel as a little sister, you know, and you feel like, you know, she's the star. She's the star.
Because I was thinking about the school, scholarships, all that type of stuff. We could have, you know, because both of y'all could be on the doggone Olympic team. That's what I'm waiting for.
I know, right?
But,
no.
But, okay, so you've done these different things, and you got your family and your children. Mm-hmm. As a mother, what kind of, and I'm asking in terms of because it's going to be different for every child. And I don't want to sit here and say the way you handle it is perfect for everybody, but everybody's situation is different. What was the conversations like for you as a mother to your children?
During divorce, you mean?
During the divorce, before, during, and after, because unfortunately our children do see these things. Or hear these things, and then even if you can shield it from them, we all know children are smart. And then if they don't get it, somebody else may say something, all these different things. So what were these conversations like for you, and what was said for you?
Sure, it's an ongoing conversation. It's still, you know, years later, it's still a conversation piece. But initially, they were so little when I first left. They were so young that, really, my oldest, he somewhat understood, but he's, you know, but the 2-year-old and the twins, they were just kind of clueless. You know, I knew that they missed their dad just by, you know, certain actions. You know, sometimes babies don't know what to say or what to do, so they get really emotional. So they would cry or things like that, or be extra clingy. So I knew then that they missed their dad. But as they got older, you know, able to tell them things, you know, like, your dad and I, we both love you. We're both here for you. You know, even though we don't live in the same household, you know, we still love each other even. You know, I'll tell them, yes, I love your dad. You know, I never want to hold him in a bad light because I think that's, you know, kids find their identity in their fathers. And so I never want my children to see themselves as bad. You know, that's who they identify with. That's who they get their name from. So, you know, I don't want them to say, okay, well, dad's a bad guy, so I must be bad. Because that's where they find their identity. So I always esteem him. And you know, even when he get on my last nerve, I still do that. We talk very openly about divorce. You know, we're not married. You know, daddy's not married to mommy anymore. Doesn't mean we don't love each other. Just means we're not compatible. We can't be together. And so, you know, they understand. They don't necessarily like it, but they understand.
Understand. Miss Monica Ball has a question. Go ahead, ma'am.
How you doing, Dan?
Sure.
Thank you for sharing your story. As a person that have been abused, and I'm glad you shared your story, by you having kids now, do you be more protective to make sure you kind of, like, overly protective to make sure that they don't be violated the same way?
Oh, yes. That's a very valid question, you know, because my ex-husband, he came from a very wholesome, you know, spiritual household, and he never saw anything like that. He was really sheltered. And so for me, it was a very different experience. And, you know, he could be very liberal and, you know, hey, you know, yeah, let him take the kids. And all of a sudden I'm like, no. No, you're not going to anybody's house. Mm-hmm. You're not spending the night. You know, mm-hmm. I'm still like that to this day. You know, I have very open conversations with my children. I do occasionally let them go stay with a friend, but please believe it's people that I know very well. I've met the parents. I've, you know, mm-hmm. talked with them extensively, and usually I know it's really bad, but I call them several times while they're there.
Oh, Jesus.
We have open conversation about, you know, private parts and, mm-hmm. you know, and making sure that no one sees or touches, or if mm-hmm. they do, he makes sure you tell, things like that. Mm-hmm. I am very conscientious about that, very much so.
Yeah, let me ask you a question. I have a show, my show called Real Talk with Monica, and I had a doctor on there. She's a psychiatrist and named Dr. Bazzani. And it always something in the in African American community why we don't discuss the stigma of incest, why we don't mm-hmm. have that question about mm-hmm. about that this discussion about just having Leroy or just having certain people.
Uncle Fonzo.
Yeah, Uncle mm-hmm. Fonzo is not the good Uncle Fonzo. And then you don't believe the child because they mm-hmm. think children are always lying. And then when children are right, then it's like you feel so bad because sometimes you got to listen to children because sometimes they're giving you the warning signal. So that's good. You are very a keen parent because some parents are not that keen to listen.
Oh, yeah, they block it out themselves because
it happened to them.
Exactly, yeah. And they don't know how to communicate because that was the whole thing of mental health and sexual abuse has been so, I don't even know what the best word for it, but it's been tortured in mm-hmm. all communities, but so much in the Black community because it was, it's not a something. It's learned. It's taught, mm-hmm. and it was.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And to your point, you know, Stephen, the thing that I remember most about, you know, the sexual abuse was my cousin's husband who did it, mm-hmm. and the thing that I remember the most, Stephen, was she actually knew. She knew that he did it. She caught him one time. She caught him. And, you know, the thing that, you know, I was embarrassed. I really didn't know what to say. But I remember she was dressing me for church. She was putting on my dress. And I had to be maybe 5 years old. And she looked at me and she said, "Don't ever let a man touch you like that." Right? Now, as a 5-year old, I'm thinking it's my fault. I let him do it. Mm-hmm. You hear what I'm saying? Like, so in my mind, I'm thinking I did something wrong. Mm-hmm. I did something wrong. And so if I did something wrong, I'm not going to tell. You see what I mean? Like, so in that you have to let children know that it is okay to tell. It is okay. If something feels inappropriate, it is. If it feels wrong, it's wrong. And you make sure you tell somebody.
How is it now, as you know, when you're, and I imagine because you got all boys, but I can imagine.
I have one girl. I snuck her in. Okay. She's one of the twins.
Okay, I'm sorry. I misunderstood. Please forgive me. So how is it now that you seeing the twins being the youngest and one of them being the girl? How is it now for you dealing with that?
Again, like I said, just keep that conversation going. I keep it open. You know, one of the things that I saw, I think it was a Periscope. Oh gosh, I wish I remembered this doctor's name, but she said, of course, that, you know, the sexual discussion should be had. She said, eight is too late. Mm-hmm. Eight is too late. So by age eight, you know, kids should already have a good idea, you know, not necessarily about the, you know, intimate details of sex, but they should have an idea of what's right and what's wrong, what feels right, what, you know, what should feel right and what should feel wrong. And she also said that, you know, one of the ways that we are victimized, or that, you know, our children are victimized, is by not sharing or not using proper names for the private parts.
Exactly.
You know, like we want to call it cookie, pocketbook, and all this other stuff. She's like, no, you need to call it what it is. So your children, you know, they don't come across as victims. They come across as educated.
That's true. So, I can imagine those boys now when they get older and the girls start coming and the boyfriends start coming, you are not going to be a happy child.
Oh my gosh. You know, my son, my oldest son is 11 and he has swag already.
Oh no, gosh.
He has swag already. So I'm about to beat the girls off with a stick. I see it coming already.
Is he now like trying to, you know, iron his clothes, press it a little bit, trying to make sure he get the right clothing
course.
And all that stuff?
Does it smell good? Yes.
Oh gosh. It's starting early.
Yeah, 11 years old. Mm-hmm.
So now you're transitioning on to this. So now you moved on from sales. You've got, you've gone into,
it's still sales, baby, just mortgage sales.
Okay, mortgage sales. And then now you're real estate and things of that nature. What made you decide to go into that versus a thousand one? And you could have been a doctor, far as I'm concerned. What, you know, what made you decide to go in that direction?
Yeah, again, well, you know, I did the cellular sales for a while, and, you know, that was great. But I actually did a little bit of mortgage sales. When I was married, I kind of had a little side hustle. I call it a side hustle. So I always like to have something, you know, in my back pocket to generate income. And so this was before the market crashed, of course. So I would originate loans. I'd spend, I don't know, maybe five, six hours on a file and get paid $3,000. You know, that's great. So, of course, now the business is not as lucrative, but it still, you know, presents this opportunity for freedom. So I'm able to have a flexible schedule. Obviously, with four children, that's important because we have, you know, doctor's appointments and the dentist and somebody's sick or, you know. So working a regular 9-to-5 as a single mom with four children can be very difficult. So I chose a profession that I love, or actually love real estate.
And there
you
go.
So that became my passion, and then just wanting to help people, wanting to see people invest in themselves and actually purchase their own homes, and instead of paying rent, throwing money out the window, you know, reinvesting that money into themselves.
That's what I talk a lot about, credit repair, and helping people understand your first stage of investment is your own home ownership and things.
That's right. That's right.
Well, let me ask you something about not too long ago. I bought a house like 6 years ago. What is the hidden secrets? You know, like back then, it seemed like people had got into the market, and the hidden tricks about buying a house if you're not really ready to buy. Especially to African Americans, you know, they thinking that they can just get this house.
I could keep you up for the answer.
Yeah, I know. You know, they're not really ready, and I'm not calling some people out. And I know that they get this house and then they always constantly can't pay the mortgage.
And back me up to now and correct me if I'm wrong. One, before they're doing all of this, it's just like people need it. I think a lot of people in our Black African American community, we're not financially educated.
Yes.
And the reason being, it is not to belittle anybody, but it's just that what was available to us. Mm-hmm. I can speak just from me being an old person that likes to go out and research it, mm-hmm. but I can speak very well. What we had available in Martinsville is different going to be available in D.C. Mm-hmm. or any other richer places. So one, the amount of education was not available to all different areas due mm-hmm. to financial areas. That's one. Mm-hmm. Two, before the crash in 07, 08, things of that nature, mm-hmm. I should really say 06, what happened is that so many people pushed it on you, especially when mm-hmm. Bank of America was coming in. They just getting over the hump from being mm-hmm. taking all the debt from Nations Bank. And saying, you know, get this. You can pay the rent, you can pay this. Mm-hmm. But people don't feel there's extra costs and a variety of things. So people don't understand paying $700, $800 in rent mm-hmm. is not the same as paying $800 a mortgage.
Yeah.
Because there's upkeep and all these other different things. So many people were beyond what have you. Mm-hmm. Too many people did not have the jobs that were not stable in terms of hours mm-hmm. up and down mm-hmm. where you can go. So now, and at that time, people were just buying. And then we had so many people that did have a little bit of money were buying the houses but did not know what to do with them correctly. Am I correct going on, Antonelle?
Yeah. And just.
Hello? Oh, no, we lost you, Tenille.
Oh, wow, lost you.
Oh, no, that's it. Doggone the banks have got to the phone lines already.
They
say we ain't telling the truth down here.
Yeah. Right, they'll say, okay, your interest rate is going to be 2%.
Start over. We lost you for about good 15 seconds. I'm sorry.
Can you hear me okay now?
Oh, yes. We were saying, dang, the banks done cut you off because we done told the truth. wherever you are now, stay there if you move. So go on ahead, ma'am.
Okay. No, I was just going to say, what happened was a lot of people got into these loan products that they had no earthly idea what they were getting into. They were into these, what you call adjustable rate mortgages.
Yeah.
That would offer a teaser rate. You know, they may say your interest rate is 2%, but what they don't tell you is that, you know, in 5 years it's going to adjust and it's going to be double that. So whereas you might have a house payment that's $700, you know, in 5 years it's going to be, you know, $1,250.
Yeah,
you talk about a shock when it comes to your house payment going up like that. And so, you know, and people weren't financially savvy enough to refinance out of those situations. So, you know, it was just a recipe for disaster. So, unfortunately, a lot of our people were the ones who were victims of the predatory lending. We either got, you know, like I said, the adjustable rate mortgages, or we got the high interest rate mortgages because, you know, people think, oh, I can get into a house for free. I'm like, no. If you trust and believe, if somebody's going to lend you $160,000 for a house, it ain't free, boo. Mm-mm. It's not going to be free. And so, you know, you may think it's free because you don't have to bring anything to the table, but you're going to pay in some form or fashion. So I think those were a lot of the things that contributed to that.
And then what happened also, and then all these other countries banked on that, on us doing that. That's why you see Greece having so much trouble today in the half of the European Union, because they banked on the U.S. economy on that.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So, but, yeah, that had a big that was a big contributing factor. So, again, my goal as a mortgage loan officer is to educate. When I go out and do seminars and, you know, speak to people about home ownership, you know, I always reiterate, you know, never borrow more than you can handle. Just because a bank may say they approve you for $160,000 doesn't mean that's how much you should borrow. You want to look at how much you plan to spend on a house payment per month. You know, a bank is going to qualify you on your gross income. You should get a house payment based on your net because you know exactly how much you have coming in from that check. And you don't want to be house poor.
Exactly.
You know, you want to live comfortably. And so, you know, you don't want to be in a big house and then you eat beanie weenies every night. That's not going to work. Not God's will.
One of the things I've always saw in that upset, and not to get too far off, but one of the things that always said to me is, you know, over the years you see these shows, they always say their budget is this, but they always spend right up to that money. And I always thought, one of the bankers told me a long time ago in financial management, whether you rent and especially your mortgage, whatever you earn in your week, that net,
yeah.
Now, that's what you have. That's what you get, because if
that's
enough,
it.
Because if something else happened to you, sick, broke, joke, whatever, laid off,
right.
Your unemployment is going to cover that part, you know, for the whole month. Or something happens if you just get 40 hours that one whole month, or you on short term disability, or whatever the case may be.
Well,
that's going to cover.
That's
you.
Another thing. Nobody gets disability to cover that.
Right. Well, see, that's where the miseducation is. Anybody that's going to get you a mortgage is going to ask you if you're working. Mm-hmm. What type of, because you don't have to rely on your job. You can get short term disability. They got the doggone commercial all the time, Aflac. You know,
sure,
anybody
sure.
else. You know, just so, but people don't see the funny duck, but they don't pay attention. What it, not just using them, but just anybody. So that extra $20 that you're kicking out for short term disability could save your home.
Right.
You know, if something has
from
happened.
From foreclosure, absolutely.
And so that's the type of things that
so
goes
we
on.
Have to educate ourselves. You know, not only about just our wellness, our physical wellness, our mental health, you know, mental health, but we also have to get financially healthy. We have to do estate planning. We have to talk about what happens should I pass away. God forbid.
That's another thing.
I don't
want
to think
discuss.
About it, but we need to talk about it.
Yes,
you know?
She's leaving me $1 million in her will after her children. I thank her so very much.
I got you, Steven.
Thank you. Going, continuing on, all this developed into I Overcame.
Sure, yes. Yes, and I don't know if you can hear me beaming, but I Overcame was, it was given to me, and I don't mean to sound all spiritual and deep, but it literally was given to me by God.
Hey, we
and
tell the truth here. Keep in mind, we tell the truth.
I'm just keeping it real, you know?
There you go.
Yeah, keep it real. Real talk.
I'm just keeping it real. It was given to me by God. And, you know, so I found myself counseling people. Now, I'm not a counselor. I don't have a counseling degree. So I'm not, you know, a PhD in psychology
But you slept at the Super 8 last
night. I can speak to my experience. I can speak to what God has delivered me from. I can speak to the fact that, you know, strangers sometimes walk up to me and start just telling me things that they've been through and ask for prayer even. And so I realize and recognize that that's a call of God on my life. Mm-hmm. And so God has commissioned me to, you know, encourage, empower, to motivate, to inspire people. Mm-hmm. That if I, a single mother raising four children by myself, going through a divorce, you know, being fatherless, being molested and raped, if I can overcome those obstacles and still find health and balance and strength and sanity and a piece of success, then you can too. Because everybody can say that they've overcome something. And, you know, what his name is Tommy Tenney. It's a preacher by the name of Tommy Tenney. He says that you have to drink or draw from the well from which you've been drinking. And the well that I've been drinking from for the past 6 years has been a well of, you know, just, oh, Lord, learning how to forgive, overcoming insecurity, overcoming fear, overcoming disappointment, overcoming rejection, you know, overcoming people's attitudes and opinions of me, overcoming being broke, overcoming bad credit, the list goes on and on. So that's the well that I've drank from over the past 6 years. And I'm not ashamed, to say that, because it all, Romans 8:28 says, all things work together for the good, for them that love the Lord and who are called for his purpose. And I know that I'm called for his purpose. And so I have to draw from that well and be able to pour a drink for someone else and say, hey, you know what? I've drank from this well before. There is, refreshing. There is something that's coming that's greater. There is something to look forward to. You can make it. You can make it through, It's just something that I know God has commissioned me to do.
Amen to you on that one. So now with I Overcame is providing a platform, a portal. Is a better word,
sure.
I would say.
Sure.
For people, outreach, whether you via your words, your ministry, a talk, a conversation piece, whatever the case may be, I Overcame is providing that, home. Spiritual justification with you in that gift that God has given you, or a journey that he's brought you through and still working with you.
And it's helping you. It's a daily process.
It's a daily process and things, because I know you. If you get those moments, I'm heading out the door. But, it's still working with you, and you're finding that energy and that peace to go forward with.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yes. And so, I'm just amazed at how things work. I went to this conference, Young Leaders Conference in Atlanta, Georgia, a couple of weeks ago. It's at the end of November, hosted by Elder Mark Moore and Faith Covenant Cathedral in Atlanta, Georgia. And so I went to that conference, and there were just some dynamic speakers there. There were people who, were able to teach about branding and marketing, which was my initial purpose for going, was to kind of help with my business, because when you are a mortgage loan officer, you are your own business. If you don't work, you don't eat. It's a commission-based job. Same thing with, with being a real estate broker. If you don't work, you don't eat. It's a commission-based job. So, the challenge is always to try to reinvent yourself and market yourself in different ways and brand yourself so that people, kind of get this idea of who you are and what you do. And so my purpose for going to that conference was just that, to go for that purpose, but I got so much more. Robin Ware, who was one of the guest speakers there, she said something that was life-changing to me. I knew that God had purposed in my heart to minister to those who were, hurting long time ago, years ago, because our experiences are never for ourselves. They're for, to help someone else. And so one of the things that I struggled with that I had to overcome was, the fear of failure, or the fear that, oh my gosh, if I start this thing, who's going to listen? who's going to actually listen to it?
So, a woman, a divorced woman, single kids, abuse.
Right.
Yeah.
but I'm like, who's going to listen?
There's
and
a lot
so
out there.
The Robin Ware said to everyone was, your audience is waiting for you if you would only show up. Just show up. And for me, that was so powerful because, I'm worried about, who's going to hear me. I'm worried about who's going to listen, who can I impact. But that's the commitment. God says, don't worry about that. You just testify. You just be my witness. You be a light, and I'll do the rest. So for me, that was phenomenal.
Amen. Ma'am, I just want to say I appreciate you. First of all, thank you, everybody that's still listening to us on live and for live and radio, listening to us on the TuneIn application, the website. Everybody that's paying attention to us, on Periscope. And forgive us for having to stop and start. Periscope will let you get a few minutes and start over again. But I thank you so very much for all of this and things. And I need you to do me a favor. Can you tell everybody how they can an email and spell your name correctly so people can find you? And how can people find you and speak to you and offer a blessing to you, ma'am?
Sure. I am on Facebook. Tenial Hairston, T-E-N-I-A-L, Hairston, H-A-I-R-S-T-O-N. You can also check out my Facebook page, I Overcame, and that's a slash with Tenial Hairston behind it. That's capital I, Overcame, O-V-E-R-C-A-M-E. You can inbox me there. I'm also on Twitter, at Tenial Hairston. I'm also on Instagram, at Tenial Hairston. You can find me there, too, so... just feel free to inbox me. That's probably the easiest way. If I try to spell out my email address, it's going to take too long. So I'm going to streamline that. I'm going to work on it.
Not a problem. Oh, we're going to work on it. I'm going to have to come down there, and we're going to get some video conferencing going. We got to get you on Periscope with everybody else as well and share this message because there's a lot that's out there. And, again, forgive me for sounding a little bit more off than normal. My throat's out of it recently.
Oh, but, no, you're fine. You're fine.
But I thank you for the bother of my heart. Thank you, and I thank your family and everything else for continuing the love and the joy and everything. Like I said, I could go down there $100,000 for any time for y'all in need. So I thank you, and you always have a family and friend here. And anything that you got going on, you know, hit me up. I'll get it out there for you.
I appreciate it, Stephen. I thank God, and I've already started getting speaking engagements, and it's just been phenomenal. So I'm thankful for the opportunity. I appreciate it.
That's not a problem. I'm gonna get you with my team up here. We're gonna get you out there. So you know, but besides the real estate on those $1 million houses, we're gonna get you on some $1 million speaking to Kate.
All right, now I'm gonna hold you to that.
You know. So by the time Hillary or whoever gets in office in the second term, you know, females is that we're gonna get you up on there. We're gonna have you and Monica and a few others. I don't need to speak. Just you don't have to give me anything. Just give me a couple of dollars on the side. Let me ride in the limo and take a picture with y'all.
I'll
be
good.
That's all I ask. And things and so forth. So, but and by the way, of all the kids, who's running the house? The little girl.
Oh, you know it. That's my diva. She runs them boys.
Not a problem. I thank all of you and everything. And please, God bless. And I'm going to hit you up a little bit later on tonight. Okay.
Okay. God bless you, and thank you for having me.
Thank you. Bye bye.
Okay. Bye bye.
How do you feel about that, Miss Monica?
Oh, she was a wonderful person, man. Seemed like she just went through a whole lot of testimony and praise to God. Not the same journey through I went through, but some of the same faith by God. Mm-hmm. And the same struggles, you know. Just imagine just to have children. That's just a double.
Four.
Yeah. Double, and just to pick up and go and start a new place, and it ain't nothing but faith.
And it's hard because and she gonna probably yell at me for the physical dimension, but these are small women. Miranda is for something, and she's not bare. I don't think she's Janelle. I think maybe 4'11". I don't think she's 5 foot. So you got four children.
Yeah, she's David going against Goliath. I mean,
and so you got somebody the physical abuse, I call.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of emotional, financial abuse. Mm-hmm. There's just so much going on, and it's touching because I work with Box Cutter, and we do the education of domestic violence and getting the word information out there. And
she had a story.
Yeah,
and somebody's gonna listen to that and.
Unfortunately, too often of a story.
Yeah,
that too many people
but somebody gonna listen to and wake up and say, "Let me get the hell on out of that," because she did it. I'm gonna get out of it.
Amen. And if she's still listening, please, sweetheart, keep on pushing and things. Haven't seen anything updated yet on the Freddie Garrett Gray thing. I'm curious if you know the story and such nature. But tell us a little bit about for those who don't know. Okay, you are from where?
Yeah, I'm born and raised from Emporia, Virginia.
Emporia, so how did you find your way into the city?
Well, my parents in Emporia, Virginia. My father was a military my mother military. So what happened was, hello, Periscope.
Hey, we're getting a bunch of hearts. I missed who's hearting us. So if you say hello again, I'll catch you. But thank you.
So any military people out there, get a shout out. 82nd Airborne, that's my father. He was in the military. So
he's an Air Force guy.
No, not Air Force. Military, baby. He was in the Air Force. The Air Force. No, he was in the Fort Bragg. Fort Bragg. He was in the U.S. Army. So he jumped off the airplanes. He was crazy.
So you're a paratrooper.
Yeah, he was a paratrooper. Yeah, 82nd Airborne. And my mom was in the military. And they, she was pregnant when they had me. So my mom got out, and my dad was in for a little bit, and then he slipped 2 discs back, and then, yeah. So from
see, you can't be jumping out those planes too long. Once you have a child, you gotta cut that mess.
Yeah, and then my grandmother, I always tell this story. She helped raise me. That's why I got some of my roots the way I do. Corrine. She's a good woman. Corrine Irene Taylor, they call her Bird, baby.
Her whole co-host, her grandmother, who she named the business off of, her name was Corrine. Popular name back then.
Yeah, man. She named me off of General Hospital fans, Monica LaRue. That's how I got my name.
Lord Jesus.
Yeah, man. I was young and a wrestler. She had them all. She had a strength.
So it's either Monica LaRue or Erica Kane.
You got it, man.
Oh, Lord Jesus. Are you as that bad?
Huh?
Are you as bad as she is?
Nah, I was in the Young and the Wrestlers, man. Let me tell you a story. Fast forward, I was in L.A. That's going to be my next stop. I'm going to go back to L.A., man. I used to date a gal out there. That's my L.A. days, man. I love L.A. I was hanging out with the stars at one point.
Oh, we got some stories we need to share.
I ain't gonna tell. I met Angie Stone. I ain't gonna tell. So I had some of them people. They act like they all like no one to D'Angelo, but I'm gonna leave it alone.
Well, they deserved each other. They both crazy.
Yeah. But I went down there and I went into Victor at the airport in LAX, man. And because I was dating a guy named Travis, he had a limousine business, Anytime Limousine Service. I ain't never forget it. We was going on a girls trip, and we met some basketball star, Quentin Richardson. He was playing for the Clippers. Man, I could have messed with a basketball star. You wouldn't have me up in here. Would have went with this dumb girl. I ain't gonna call her out. She's still in Virginia, man. She gonna open her mouth up, man. We was sitting up in this man. Now here I go telling some stories. I had a crazy time, man. L.A. is the place. But anyway, it wasn't nothing but God for me to meet this guy. He was a driver, and everybody was tripping. Talking about, he just a limo driver. Come to find out, that man was a multimillionaire. So, ladies, don't be shagging somebody to driving, because he might be the businessman. And he was a multimillionaire, baby.
Oh, Lord
Jesus.
Yes,
indeed, baby.
Who's sending us all the hearts? I appreciate it. Who's sending us the hearts? Say hello to me. I know, Mr. McGriffin, you're up there. Thank you so very much. I'm seeing all of this stuff.
Yeah.
I
was like, who's up with that? Yeah.
Oh, Ms. Griffin says no prejudging.
no prejudging.
Look, I know Ms. Griffin got some of them face up in there. Who's up? First of all, give a shout out. Hello, everybody announce who's out there on Periscope listening.
Tamika Griffin. Listening.
I know
real
we got a whole bunch of other people, some other places around the country. Who else is out there? Come on, say hi.
Come on, say hi.
I'll give you a lollipop if you say hi. Okay, they're scared. We'll find out. But, so you're hanging out in L.A.
Yeah, so hang out in L.A., man. And I was hanging with the guy, and first he was just the limo driver. He come to find out he was a multimillionaire. He was cool, everything. So we was hanging out, and we was on our way back, and we ran into Victor Newman. And the girls were like, that's Victor Newman. And the girls was all on him. He said, ladies, I got to go. He said, gotta go, man. It was, women was all on Victor, man. The man looked good. Fine as wine, baby. I said, man, leave Victor alone.
That man, you know, Victor Newman.
Old age, man. He drank red wine. And that's what it is, like Jesus.
Victor Newman. You know, that man been married, divorced, and slept with his sister, his son's wife, everybody hey. Else. Stephanos is another one. That's yes, my mom was a Stephanos fan.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, my grandma and mom loved Stephanos.
Yeah. Man, Victor looked good, baby. I said, man, if I went with Travis, man, I said, man, I would have took the ride with Victor that
night. It's sad. The man don't got no time. You know they film like 45 weeks, 50 weeks out of the year.
Yeah, he was a nice guy, though. He was. He was a real cool celebrity I met. Another cool celebrity. Now I'm going to get down to some of the cool ones I met was David Allen Grill. Cool guy. Hung out with him. He was really, really cool. Maybe on Living in Living Color. Mm-hmm. He was really cool. I hung out with him. He was really nice. Let me tell you who's nasty, stuck up is John Sally. Oh, he was awful. 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 man, don't hang out with him. You know, I was like, man, I said, you need to go and sit around. No one in this show got canceled.
Ooh.
And then let me tell you something. Angie Stone, I said, no wonder she got in some trouble. I was at Roscoe Chicken and Waffles. You ever go to L.A., man? Now, I ain't been to Gladys. I went down to Atlanta. Mm-hmm. That was real cool. And I was like, oh, you know, because, you know, I wasn't really too much in the starstruck type thing.
Oh, you weren't too much when you tell that lie. We're keeping it real hard. We tell that lie.
Yeah, we're keeping it. And so I went down there and I said, we saw Angie Stone. And then she had one of these girls with her. And she was like, only you can do once for me. I said, what? She said, only you gonna do one, either sing or take a picture. I said, what? And see, I listened to what Steve Harvey said. See, when you get like that, and that's like, if that's what God said, when you get to the point that you thinking you all that, because fame can go just like that. You got to always treat people the same way. And don't never think, this is my grandma say, don't never think them bridges too big, baby, because them bridges going to be taken off, because you always going to need your friends and your fans to uplift you. In your life.
Yeah, Ms. Griffin was saying, wow, and a couple of people were saying, Ms. Michelle K. Robinson, hello to you too. It is, and this is people just don't act like that, you know. Yeah. You'd be surprised because as quick as you come up, you can go down way faster.
Oh, yeah.
And it's a fickle world just as much, and, you know, those people are going to remember. Now, I'm not expecting everybody to go around and I got a million. People are not as rich as sometimes they think you are.
Yeah.
And then at the same time,
you're going to be broke just like that.
Right.
Look at all these people that get all of this money. They don't know how to handle it. And they get drugged. But and they get the wrong panhandler.
Because, see, that's one.
Yes.
And then you know what happens is too many of them rely on not renewable things. That's not renewable. Too many of them are they're self-employed.
Right.
They're not business operators and investors. And even with
and
those
they're not
rich
educated.
People.
They don't go like we're doing. Steven,
see,
like,
tonight we done passed out about 10, 15 different things.
Yeah,
easily.
We done told them, like I told you, like I said, what I told you about the blessing on what Real Talk with Monica can do, and some people are blowing me up on Facebook, and what I told you, I said, I got an LLC license, and I said, I don't know how this thing is going to blow off the video on Real Talk with Monica, Gone Country. And I said, I don't know what the hell I'm going to do. I went in and I said, I've just put this video together and it's just blowing up. And I said, and then somebody said, well, what you gonna do next? And I said, I don't know. It's what God gave me to do. And I didn't have, let me tell you something, Steve. You gonna look at me like I'm crazy. I was on food stamps just this past 3 years, okay? When my job had fought me tooth and nail. When I'm on my toe, well, let me fast forward, guys, because sometimes I like to keep fast, keep things going. I know we on the time slide.
No, we got time.
Okay. All right. Well, I told Steven my story back in 2010. I almost physically died from drugs that a physician gave to me to cure acid reflux. Okay? I didn't know what the doctor had given me. It was a sample drug. And I didn't know what was going on. And I started feeling sick and ill from that. So what happened was, from that, I started getting ill. So I went to the doctor and I said, look, I'm turning red and this and this. And it's like, well, maybe it's something you eat. And that was my primary doctor. And at the time, I had just turned 33 years old. And didn't know on my 33rd birthday that I was getting ready to die. And it was almost like Big and Smalls, ready to die. And didn't know that I had moments from death from that time period that I was getting ready to die. So what happened was, from that, I went into a stages of series of death. My arms started turning black. I went into 105 temperature. I went into cardiac arrest. My skin turned black. I had lost consciousness and everything. They didn't know what to do to me. And all I know that I had worked part-time job with my mom at Burger King. She was a restaurant owner. And I had my Latino friends and her workers. They did prayer vigils for me, and I didn't know it at the time, but I had a sense from God. But from before that, I had a loud voice in my right ear. They said, you're getting ready to die. And I didn't know what to do. And it wasn't nothing but my girlfriend to hurry up and take me to the emergency room. And then that's when these series of things that started to happen to me. And when you go through something like that, a death process, it reopens your life. I had to learn how to walk and talk again. I had was in a coma state, a medical-induced coma for 12 days at 33 years old, and I just had celebrated my birthday. And I was, at the time, a beautiful young woman, and I just not too long ago came from California, had just celebrated everything, had just moved into, not too long ago, had a brand-new house. I had a government job. I had everything that I thought going for me. And then that's when everything got knocking back from me. And when I got incubated almost like a baby, to have people to wash my tail, it humbles you. It really does. It humbles you to the point, and it make you think. And I saw in my journey through death, I saw some of the stuff that we got going on now, racism. I saw some of that in my journey that God wanted me to see. He foreseen me some of this stuff, and it was scary. And God saved me. And he, I didn't want to see it, but I'm seeing it now. And it's even scarier because I still did not finish my battle with the enemy. And the enemy tried to take me out so many times, but God was a bigger force. And people can say I'm crazy. They always try to say I was crazy. I said, man, but let me tell you something. Ain't nothing crazier than God. When he told me in that hospital room, and he said, you're not going to have kidney dialysis no more. And after I spoke to God, it was a bright image. And he said four things to me. It was a voice, and I didn't see. It was like a bright light. You don't see God. You don't. It was a bright image. He said, number one, he said, you're going to stop having kidney dialysis, because that was killing me. If anybody went through kidney dialysis, you know what it meant to have it. You go through a four-hour treatment, and then you go a six-hour. That's how badly damaged my kidneys was. I didn't have no kidneys at all. I had all my organs was shutting down, and it's by none but the grace of God that I was still living.
So if anybody went through kidney dialysis and went through what I went through, they can't believe that I survived it. And I still to this day see my kidney doctor. And it's been almost 5 years, going on 6. And so anybody knows, if you didn't overcome that severe illness of going through that, you know you have been definitely blessed. And so I prayed to God, and I had foreseen all of my sins. I talked and I prayed to God that night before he had surfaced to me. But during that, he said, number one, you're not going to have kidney dialysis. Number two, you're going to learn the truth about everything. Number three, you're going to be financially blessed. And number four, you're going to see a lot of stuff. And he was not lying. And the only thing I have not done yet is being financially blessed, because the enemy had blocked everything for me to be financially blessed. God had put paths in my way for me to be financially blessed. I never seen how much a cruel world this really is, Stephen. I have not. I have been through the legal system. I never been in trouble my whole entire life. I never filed a legal case until now, until God told me I was following his orders. So when God told me to do something, this man saved me the next exact day. They had put me on this crazy mess that them doctors did to me. The next day, they said, Miss Ball, your kidneys miraculously got here. They cussed. I said, man, that ain't nothing but God. Ain't nothing powerful than God. Let me tell you something. Doctors are a blessing to God. When they don't know something supernatural, it's God. So when that doctor cousin, I told that man, you ain't got nothing to tell me, because I know it was God. You don't know the conversation I done had in this room, and I ain't, don't tell me. He threw the papers down. They set me up for the kidney dialysis place on Chamberlain Road. I still got them papers to the day, baby, as my testimony. They had set me up. They had already prophesied with me, had everything set up, the bed, the rehab center off of Mechanicsville. I still had to go through the rehab. They was going to put me in a bed. Mm-mm. God took that away. He said, no, sir, you're not one of my children. You've been through too much. I had my skin fell off. I looked like an ugly monster, Stephen. If you see pictures of me, you wouldn't even believe it, what these drugs did to me. And then they covered up for this doctor. He was a part of that covenant. That's what I tell people. But that's okay. God said, everybody that has a sin, they have to deal with their own. And guess what he gave to me, baby? He gave me Real Talk with Monica. And that ain't nothing but my angels above, my grandmother, my spirits above that gave me this. And let me tell you something. Let me tell you another testimony I'm going to give to you. I had a job making about $60,000. They talked to me like a damn dog, man, for doing God's work. I told that man when I got sick, I still got to see my doctors and stuff. But when I got to do God's work, and when you ain't telling me to do God's work, because that's the man of God saved me. When you telling me I can't do God's work, I got to get the hell on out of here. And I ain't never looked back. In August the 15th, 2013, baby. Because I was doing God's work, and he talked to me like a dog, baby. He talked to me like a slave on the job. You better get that. I said, no, sir, I'm doing God's work. You're not going to talk to one of his childs like that. And God said, you ain't coming back up in here. And I went through food stamps, you hear me? Y'all here on this thing, that's why you better go on YouTube channel Real Talk with Monica, because God said, you're going to support this girl from Rich, and I ain't look back. They're going to take care of me. I said, I've been out on disability. You're going to take care of this child of God, because I'm doing God's work. And I ain't going to have nobody talking to me like a dog,
when I'm raising money for one of my employees that was sitting in a bed, you hear me? Sitting in a morgue for 10 days. I knew something wasn't right with him. And when I got that phone call, and I know some of y'all listening on that phone, when y'all get that phone call from God, and I got it that day on August 15, 2013, they said, Monica, we need your help. And that's a call of God. And they said, my husband is dead. We need your help. We need you to raise some money to put him in the ground. I stopped what the hell I was doing that day. And I raised them money up, and I did it. And when my boss gonna talk to me like a dog for doing the right thing and gonna talk to me and telling me to sit down for me to do the right thing to help put somebody in the ground, you crazy. I'm doing God's work, baby. And when I knew that day was funny, Stephen. I knew it. And I never knew it. I knew that day was crazy. I knew it. I saw butterflies and everything. And let me tell you something. When I talked to that wife on that phone, she said, he like be drew butterflies. I knew it. I knew something was funny that day. And when that man talked to me like that, God said, no more. It's not time for me to come in that place no more. I suffered. And I took on the establishment and I did everything. But God said, my season is coming. And I said, and I tried to go. I said, no. God said, don't go back up in there. He said, because they don't deserve you. You deserve to be where I tell you to be. And that is to do God's work. And that's why I have this show, Real Talk with Monica. That's why I'm supporting everybody that's around me. It's about building a connection of connectivity, of blessings. This is what I was built to do. And I never knew what my grandmother, Corrine Irene Taylor, told me. She said, you're going to be a star. And I said, I thought I was going to be a star in that government job because I tried to do everything right by them people. They didn't never like me because I was different. And I said, no wonder they didn't like me. And I didn't, because I never flew by there because I tried to work with people. Now I'm going to do my own thing. And I got a business, and I told them, when they don't like you, you're going to be working for me because I know how to treat people right. And that's what we need to have. Black-owned businesses. I'm professional. When Steven said 6:30, I got here at 6:25, baby. I'm on time. You hear me? On time, baby. We need to break the stigma, okay? PhD. I'm going to be everything what I want to do. I wrote to President Barack Obama, baby. I didn't call that man out. I said, look, Michelle, she hot. She a good-looking woman. I said, I like Michelle. I said, look, Barack ain't listening to me because I wrote the letter, baby. You need to support this girl down here in Richmond, Virginia because they after me because I'm speaking some real talk, baby. They don't like it. Because grandmother Corrine Irene Taylor, she stood behind me and on that deathbed, and she said, they ain't going to take her out. If they do, I'm going to take all of them out. Because I was brought back to do something special. And that is, baby, we is here to get some stuff going, baby. Okay? Support Legacy. Support this radio station. Support us. That's what we need to do. I'm getting tired of this. We need to support us. Subscribe to us. I looked on your channel. It should be 100, 200. How many people in Virginia around here?
Between Richmond, and you're talking about Richmond and Rapid
yes.
County?
Yes, sir.
474,000.
That's what I'm saying. And how many of us are there? We be on this YouTube. We need to support one another. That's what I'm trying to tell these people. Support us. And we're going to turn around and support you. Don't be scared. We can't be scared of something we don't already know. It's getting, like I told people, look what's going on in Chicago. It is a travesty.
And I called it out. And I said, look what happened with Ron Emanuel. And I said, he need to get his ass out of there. Excuse my language.
That bothers me because this is where my issues regarding the president. And I think, first of all, that was your boy. And that, you know, he got up.
I am a Republican. Black Republican and a / independent. No, I left Ben Love the Democrat at the problem. When I wrote letters, when I going through, they ignore me. They threw my letters in the trash.
The way I feel is I'm just independent. That's your boy. All this happened under your watch.
Yeah.
And things of that nature. And if you didn't know, shame on you. Now, granted, things happen. You have to empower because no one's not going to know everything. You have to make the right decisions to empower people. And such a gentleman that was so much of a control and had everybody on point when you were at the White House, and then you did everything you could to get out there as fast as you can, fought whatever laws to try to make sure you show that you had residency in order to run, and then for all this to happen underneath your watch is a travesty.
The
governor that they got rid of, that. There's nowhere we're near as worse as this.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah, it needs to be a federal inquiry. I mean, right.
Some people need to be in jail without bail.
Yeah.
And I feel that, yes, there's, you know, I do believe in due process, don't get me wrong. But, and this would be in jail without bail or due process, because as far as I'm concerned, this is terrorism, you know, capital crime, because you let people die. And all there is more than one head, and you're using the police chief and some of these officers as a fall person. And there's a lot of
people
that
fought
need to go
tooth and nail for that camera, that video footage not to come out. And another thing came out, it was around election time.
They had to get it out. But what they did was they found every excuse to keep it delayed so they could give him time to get an excuse, to get your bail money, to come up with an argument and everything else.
Right.
All meanwhile, everybody else and people got to suffer.
Right.
Now, at the same time, I charge people. This is where the people in the community get mad at me. But I charge this fault on both sides of the fence. The shooting and all this other stuff that goes on and stuff is also the fault within our Black community as well. And tell the truth to shame the devil. And because the issue is this. You complain about the man. You can complain about all these other different things that you want and things. Yes, I know there's a lack of education. Yes, I know there's a lack of funds.
Right.
But you know what? There's also a thing called willful ignorance. Now, those who know are at fault for not empowering and sharing and helping another person, not just lifting a hand out, but lifting a hand up. Those who were fed that information and decided not to do with it, you're just as fault. You are just as much at fault as everybody else.
Right.
Then we are also, I'm charging the people with all the crimes and stuff like that. There's all these retired people without kids, teachers, whatever. There's teachers, white, Black, whatever, walking kids home.
Right.
There should be a community of people every two blocks. There should be somebody standing there all day. Rain, sleet, snow, shine. If this was back with the, I keep forgetting, Lord forgive me, the gentleman in the 70s and 80s with the red hats that everybody complained that they were guardian angels.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
If they can do these different things, why do we need a quote-unquote single leader to do this? This is something we can do. If I see Cory Booker busting his tail out there doing every other single thing, they try to make him out to be just trying to show off. No, this man is actually putting in his work in his community. Why can't the people do? Because it starts locally. It can't just everything else be on the federal side.
My question was, where was the local legislators at the time when they was voting on these package, when they was voting for Laquan McDaniel to say, we're just voting on a $5 million plus package.
But let me go below that. we are not, so many of us are not in the voting lines. You know, just look at going to Chicago election, the local election. What was it, 18% amount of black people voted?
Right.
Same thing here, it was 14%?
Yes, that we don't attend the local elections here.
They don't know the school teachers. I'm sorry, the elected the representatives.
Right.
And it is not hard going in, who is my legislator? And then it tells you, put in your address. It tells you, so many people don't know here in Virginia, you got your state congressman and senator. Then you got your federal ones.
Yes.
And then you got your senators and the governor.
Right.
So it's 2, 4, 6, 7, and then you got your school representatives.
Right.
However many in your district. All those people should be a name, address, up and down the line.
Right.
Forgive me for not to be rude. What side of town do you live in, ma'am?
I stay on Henrico.
East or Western?
Eastern.
Okay. Now, are you familiar with cooling?
Yes.
Okay. They've down. Mm-hmm. They're putting up all this new piping for water in the community and things to fix it. Mm-hmm. Per happy for you. But they fill it in with this half-in mess over there. You see on Mechanicsville Turnpike, we long can't make that turn on 64.
Yes, for that's a long
been,
time.
It's been going on for the longest of times. Mm-hmm. Now, tell me, now, this is the county side now, mm-hmm. okay? Dare tell me that happens in Short Pump.
Oh, no.
Okay. Dare tell me that happens on anything above Azalea before you get to Hanover.
No.
In Mechanicsville.
No.
Okay. Because I probably Short Pump, that area, the entrance and exit ramp, don't have that many as many tractor trailers on that section because mm-hmm. they got to go down 250. But that place has been paid over, what, 5 times this year? Mm-hmm. That place has not been paid over 1 time. But you steady complain and joke and this, that, and the other. But will you get up and pick up the phone and make a call? You may not get to that person, but you got the representative. And trust me, every time I've called somebody by law, they have to return the call.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So just make the effort, people.
Yes.
And your local representatives and your districts.
Make
and
the
things.
Effort.
And things. So we've gotten one thing me and Marcus talk about all the time and some others, and we will totally agree, if nothing else, we have become lazy. Because now we can go to school. You may have to pay a lot of money, but you can go to college. You know, you may not get to the big schools or whatever, but if you can go, heck, you can go, you may not get to the school you want. You can graduate with a bunch of D's. Okay. Seriously, you and I, you can go, just look at DC or New York City, for example. There's thousands of colleges all left and right. You know, whatever tech, get the degree. You got them on the subways. You got them on the metros. Look at open the paper. Don't have any money, come in. Sign your life away to student loans, but you will get a degree. Okay? So whatever, you know, and I don't like the whole student loan thing. Is people are not educating what's going on with that. But still, sidebar. But still, you have opportunity to get an education. Mm-hmm. Heck, if not the degree, you got a trade program. Heck, before that, before you graduate, you can go to get another trade program. You can graduate with your CNA, go to mechanical tech, get the AST mechanic license. So now you got these things. At least you have some serviceable skill. Or, better yet, go sign up to go overseas and travel with the International Red Cross. And there's like 15 programs I can name on top of my head that beg for kids. You don't want to go to college? Fine. You don't want to go to the trade school? Fine. You don't want to go to whatever? Fine. Come volunteer with us. And you know what? Those people who come back after that have better chances getting some of the federal jobs because you got international experience and you're working with other countries. You're speaking another language and you're getting extra serviceable skills, community relations. How many people can go to Tanzania and other of these places? You volunteer. I'm going somewhere. Yes, you do. But you're gone for 2 years. You come back. Now you can go to the UN, the government, do all these other different things. Mm-hmm. So now you have more experience and skills than something that so many other people don't get to go. So why not take advantage of these opportunities?
Right.
And then this is where the conflict in our community. Let me give you an example. I know I mentioned this a few times over the weeks, and I know people are probably tired of me. But you are different of a thinking person. You remember The Wiz that came on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Did you happen to see it or mm-hmm. did you record it?
No.
Okay. You are in which decade, age decade?
70s.
Okay, so you're 70, so you're in your late 30s, early 40s.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Now, you're old enough to remember the original one.
Yes.
Did you ever happen to see the live play?
No.
Okay, all right. But does the original play and all, or the thing with the TV version, did that ever, does that hold a special place in your heart?
I don't know. I haven't seen it yet. I want to see it.
No, I'm talking about the original.
Oh, the original. Oh, yes. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Oh, yes.
Now, you have traveled. Have you had the opportunity to see other plays and things of nature often? Or do you enjoy the arts, may I ask?
Yes.
Uh-huh. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, I asked this pre-qualified question, and mm-hmm. please forgive me. Mm-hmm. To sound, mm-hmm. not to be misleading.
Yes.
It got 11.5 million people.
Right.
Okay. I complain furiously mm-hmm. about it, mm-hmm. but people are not understanding why. Mm-hmm. First, people ever found out I just trashed the thing. I did not trash it. I didn't say anything mm-hmm. about the play. Mm-hmm. My point is that we failed as a community. Mm-hmm. Because if we can watch Scandal, Housewives, all these other yeah. different shows, because mm-hmm. they say, well, they look at the initial numbers, but you got to look at the replays and mm-hmm. stuff. Like, for example, whatever reality show may get 5-6 million, mm-hmm. but that's, you and I both know, we play so many doggone times, they get the extra millions in the recordings. Mm-hmm. So they can get 15 to 20 million. Mm-hmm. I said this thing should at least got 20 million. And then people are like, why? It's a good number. You're missing the ballpark. So many kids, even if in the New York City, do not get to see plays anymore. It right. used to be get an A or get a record. You get the tickets to plays mm-hmm. or something like that. They don't do that anymore.
Right.
They're $75 to $100 starting. And that's nosebleed seats. So now we have, and then there's been thousands of, first of all, it's hard enough to get a stage play up there. Because they don't come out to see us that often.
I know.
And then so
I think Motown is coming here, isn't it?
I'm not sure.
So. I think but, the promos.
But, like, there's so many of these plays out there.
Yeah.
So now I'm thinking, okay, if you get 20 to 30 million people to watch this stuff, record it, watch it, whatever, mm-hmm. now they see this. Oh, shoot, we're going to run and get as many of these plays on TV. Just right. like when they did the, back in the 80s, it was nothing but miniseries until they
yeah.
died out.
Yeah.
Now, let me give you a relatable example. Mm-hmm. When American Idol came out, it was a phenomenon.
Yes.
Because,
and then there's that.
Because now you have every other music singing competition mm-hmm. find three halfway rememberable favorite stars. Find them some, say some witty comment to keep it funny.
Yes.
And you know, and find somebody that's the host that, you know, whatever. A metrosexual looking host and whatever. And so you got all these comments. And look at all these other cooking shows. This show is always three people. It's yes. a copycat.
Yes.
So now, how many, if you got 20 million people coming in to watch this thing, as mm-hmm. so far, now, would you not think NBC, ABC, Fox would be like, okay, what black play that was out, or any stage play mm-hmm. for that matter, we're going to start putting that on TV. And then because they canceled, and people say 11.5, you and I both know, there's shows, there are great shows, they've canceled because it's only got 11.5 million.
Yeah.
And things of that. You're not considered a success because long term, if you don't get starting to get towards that 15 million range.
Yeah, it's a higher standard.
So why not use this opportunity? Because before the movies and the videos and all mm-hmm. this other stuff that they're so conditioned to, all we had was stage.
Yes.
And things. You know, for the black theater and plays, that was weird. And then keep in mind, you had to sing, dance, and act. Mm-hmm. And you better learn how to tap, dance, and play an instrument if
yeah,
you want to stay longer.
Yeah,
so you got all these different people. Lena Horne, Eartha Kitt, Sammy mm-hmm. Davis. That's
yeah.
just the
yeah,
top
thing.
We
yeah.
got thousands of more underneath.
Yes.
So now, we don't. This is why we don't have no respect for ourselves and our culture and things of that, because we don't teach our kid our history and our past.
Mm-hmm.
So now, again, fast forward to The Wiz. Considering, yes, it's a remake of this and that and the other, and yes, it may be a silly mm-hmm. story, but it was an outlet. Just as much as A Different World helped push a lot of kids to go to college, and especially black college, how much the stage play got out there and then pushed. How many millions of people, way more than like 50, 60 million, saw Gabby Douglas? And how many more children of all cultures than saw there now that we got a first woman to black gold to get the gold?
Yes.
And everything. Other since Dominique Dawes, you didn't see too many people pushing.
No.
But now how many kids are out there pushing this now?
Yeah.
How many kids now, we see the lady, forgive me, the ballet, now getting their children out there and exposing the culture.
Yes.
So now if we can do this, now granted, Olympian is one thing. That's like the creme of the creme.
Mm-hmm.
But you see the influence and the positive effect that it has done for our children and our future generations' education. We all see the stats. You play sports, you get involved in athletics, you play an instrument, whatever, you improve your grades. So why not use this opportunity to show your children the importance of a stage play?
Yeah.
And we have Fame.
Yeah.
Debbie Allen.
Yeah, that was good. When you were saying that and my focus, when you were saying all of that stuff to me, first thing I was thinking about, man, the Cosby Show. You know, the first thing I was thinking about for me when I was growing up is that the idolized about the college experience, and that's what made me, you know, want, like the Hillman, you know, that's what made me want to go to college. You know, we don't have TV shows now to uplift because everything is social media now
and
TV, yeah.
Because, like, every other kid, boy, wanted to play basketball, football.
Yeah.
But how many of them could have been a good third baseman, but we don't push enough. We let a kid play. Think about baseball, we dog them.
Yeah.
Or better yet, you couldn't play a sport, son, maybe wrestling didn't work out or what have you.
Yeah.
Let's play an instrument, or how about, you know, you may be a good state actor. Let's learn these lines and practice something.
Yeah.
Get you involved in something. Oh, that's whack, that's sissy, that's gay, all these stupid things.
Well, we don't teach the kids to be diversified. You're just teaching them how to play sports. And I just seen something where a kid blew, just like, I was looking at this, that I'm interested in seeing this Will Smith movie, Concussions.
Okay, yeah.
And now these guys blowing these heads out, and I think I was looking at this guy now, because I'm a football fan, and Joe Haddon, and then he's out, and it's like three or four more games, and he's out for the season. And these guys getting all this money, and these guys can be, Frank Gifford, Kathy Lee Gifford's husband. Now he's donating his head, and he suffered all these brains. And then these guys got to realize.
But they already knew it.
They didn't suffered his back. Yeah.
They didn't tell it until after he died.
Yeah, until after he died. That's what I'm saying. You best set yourself up for a different career. I mean, he did in a booth.
But not everybody can do that.
Not everybody can do that.
And this is where I was saying the importance of it is the opportunity to diverse our culture. And we forget these things. And because before Will Smith, before we got on the radio and all this, public speaking for that matter, I get so many young girls that don't want to speak. And I get so many people say they don't like the camera for whatever reason.
They need to get out of it.
I've seen so many young and old. Every time, hey, I don't want to be in the camera. Get away from me. Stupid. Because there was not enough. So whatever personal tragedy, or there's not enough man, woman, child, whatever, did not foster that encouragement to love your damn self.
Yeah.
And more than anything, and to do that. Or I put a microphone. And now, granted, yes, there's some other mental disorders. I get that. I'm not dismissing those things.
Right.
But I'm talking about the superficial things that could have been corrected.
Well, you know, I'm glad you say that because, you know, I never imagined me getting in front of a camera. I was camera shy. And I think my situation, my tragedy, just pushed me along to just get me the courage and uplift to just do because what you never know when it's your time to go. So some people just need to step out their comfort zone. And that's why I encourage my children, kids, and I see them around. I take pictures. I say, come on, get in front of me. Let me interview you. Let me do something and uplift them because I was just before I was getting dressed, I was hearing these kids, you know, getting in these gun shootings, and my little nephew, he's 5 years old. He lost his father just this past Saturday. He got murdered up in Petersburg, and here he got a fatherless because senseless murder, and that's what I try to say here in Virginia. And now he's growing up without a father,
And now all of us got to team up to support him in an environment where it's just senseless murders, where we killing one another. And we don't have to do, and I always say this, we're doing modern day lynching among ourselves, killing one another. And these people need to stop this madness. When you talk about the white man and racism, you're doing it upon yourself, putting in that trigger. And that trigger, when you do it upon yourself, and now that little child don't have a daddy to call a daddy no more. But even though his daddy chose to possibly did some wrong stuff to put himself in that wrong position. So that's why I tell us we need to wake up, America, you know. And now I got to grab him and make sure he don't fall in them same traps, you know. So that's what my prayer is.
Tell us a little bit more of your, I understand why you have Real Talk.
Yes.
Tell us, and I understand the goal.
Yes.
Do you feel that this is your, what I mentioned earlier where we said gift time, this is your gift?
Yes, this is my gift from God. The tagline of my whole is, it says, I'm living out my purpose.
Okay. So, and the only reason why I'm asking is to help define criticizing, I'm just helping define. So, you want to talk and define a purpose, but you wanted the purpose. What type of purpose do you want? Okay.
Well, Real Talk with Monica is a TV show. Right now, I'm on Comcast periodically right here off the studio, and then I have a YouTube channel. Eventually, I'm going to be broadcasting to market out to be on to the major networks. Mm-hmm. And what I want my show is a variety of all types of things. And then I have some cast characters on there. But I want to give local people a voice. People that you want to never have the opportunity to speak as a guest, to have an opportunity to have different topics, different shows.
A voice, is this a voice for people? You know, obviously there's plenty of people willing to get on and speak.
Uh-huh.
But what about the voices that who want to speak but can't speak because of whatever?
Oh, it's a voice that you never would have even heard. It's a voice for everyone. It's like
unknown voices that should be heard that did not get to hear.
Voices unheard. Because one time I even tried to go down to Channel 6, try to speak about some things that was going on to me. They wouldn't even give me an opportunity. Mm-hmm. 12, 8. So I want to give people opportunity.
Okay, there you go. Now, I did that not to please.
That's right. You got to challenge me.
No. It wasn't so much of a challenge. It's more of just encouraging.
Yes,
because I want people. Because I want people to fully understand. Because there's always, we can get a voice. We can go on Blog Talk. We can come on here and get a voice. But it's like, what type of voice?
What stands out different from Real Talk?
Exactly. Because we got Real Talk. There's about 1,000 women out there saying
Real Talk. Real Talk. You're right. It ain't only but one, baby. And that's only one Real Talk with Monica, baby.
Okay. Yes. Not a problem. Oh, Lord Jesus. I'm sorry, everybody who was watching on the Periscope, the computer faint. The thing had died on me, I can sell it. So please forgive me for, you know, sometimes Periscope won't let you stay on but so long. But I appreciate you.
No problem, man.
For all that you do and things of that nature.
Thank you, and I appreciate it. Like I said, if y'all got a chance, I got my website coming out, realtalkwithmonica.com, coming out in 2016. Mm-hmm. Like I said, check my videos out. I'm on Facebook, Monica L. Ball. Like me on Facebook on Real Talk with Monica, and also on Instagram, RTWM_. And I just got a whole bunch of stuff going on, and I got a whole lot. And my hashtag is killing it for 2016.
Okay. We might need to say a different one, considering all the killing that's going on these days. I'm just offering a suggestion. Because, you know, they want to find any excuse not to give us a chance. See, that damn black people want to kill us. Just send it to Baltimore. I don't. Let's not give anybody an excuse.
Positively speaking.
Okay, we're opening the doors for 2016. How about that?
Yes, open up.
You know, benevolence 2016. We can work on this.
Hashtag
okay.
Real talk.
Hashtag real talk. Hashtag red hair. Hashtag big smile. Hashtag jamberry pink fingernails. We gonna do it all.
Yes, I'm always glamming.
You always glam. We gonna have to talk about that offline, but we are gonna work on that. So I appreciate you very much.
I appreciate it too, man. I really enjoyed it. It's been a fast 2 hours.
Oh, trust me, I could make this 10 hours easy.
I know.
This is not, look, I've sat here plenty of times. I could do this for 5 hours off the top, and it's not a problem and everything. But it's not just because I'm just that crazy person talking off my head. But it's just because I care and things of that nature, and I try to be there for people. And it is funny because, you know, recently so many more wonderful people have come on and joined the show and have been blessings, not only to me, to others. I don't get to talk that much anymore. So, and then with like six of them are women, it's like,
this is a great topic. We had a lot of discussions, and hopefully y'all get the support, and I'm definitely going to support it on my channel.
Thank you. Thank you. We're here every Tuesdays from 7 to 9, and we also have wonderful shows. The show is Marcus's. A few others of shows, you know, All Throttle, just so many different shows we have. It's just great. Email for people to contact you.
Okay, you can reach me at realtalkwithmonica@gmail.com. Like I said, you can reach me there, and also, like I said, you can, on my Facebook page, almost at shooting for 1,000 likes. I'm almost close.
And if you need sending some money for, please send the GoFundMe to Steven Sykes.
Okay, GoFundMe. All right. You got to do your support channel thing. That's what I got on mine. I got my support channel.
There you go. You're always welcomed. And you can come anytime. Just give a call. Just say, hey, you coming? Cool. We'll set a seat to the side for you. You never. You know, we tell everybody you're always welcome here because, you know, anytime you have something new, if you decide to change your hair color, will you please go let us know?
I am. Got to talk to my hairstylist. We coming up with some flies.
You know, if you need weave, I got a good weave. You can talk to Ashley Jefferson and Corinne Hair and Beauty.
Oh, wow. You got everything, Steven.
We got hair. We got photos. We got videos. We got radio. We need loans. We get housing. We try to find it all.
Gosh.
Steven Sykes Consulting. We're just going to do what we can.
You do it all.
Not a problem. But I want to say thank you very much, everybody, for listening, for your patience, your time, your energy, your prayers, and everything else in this world. This world is a crazy place. It is not fair, but what you do owe yourself is to keep the opportunity to keep on fighting. You know, I've had it rough. We all have had it rough, but at the end of the day, you have to stand up and be proud, stand up and be strong, and let go of the hate. Don't hate people because of some stupid stereotype, because of somebody saying this or somebody saying that. Make conscious and wise decisions for yourself. Understand a few certain things. When someone says you're opinionated, understand that it is not a bad thing, because people do not. Let me rephrase that. People do not understand the term opinionated, because opinionated really means that you have an opinion without regardless of the other side of view, and you're not doing your research. So we have an opinion, but you're not opinionated. When people say your judgment and judging and things, people need to understand that term as well. We all judge. Whether I call Monica and I have to make a decision, that's a judgment call. What I don't need to do and what all of you should not do is condemn. That's the word that you need to learn to use, everyone. I thank you very kindly. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, please give me a call at 804-402-2893. Leave a voicemail, and we'll be right there for you. Or you can email us at enlivenradio@gmail.com. Again, that's ENLIVEN radio@gmail.com. Again, blessings to all of you. Blessings to family and friends of a co-host. Many of you are not feeling well. I know I'm fighting here myself. And blessed to everybody that was listening on Periscope all around the world. Thank you, Michelle K. Robinson. Thank you, Tamika. Thank you, Veronica Souls. I saw you out there. Thank you, Tanil. I appreciate you and your family so very much. Monica, thank you so very much. And everybody, Please enjoy yourself and be safe, and have a blessed evening, everybody. Bye-bye.